Okay, good morning, everybody. Welcome to New Heights Baptist Church. If you would all stand with me this morning, turn to page number 83 in your hymnals. Page number 83. We'll sing "This Is My Father's World." We'll sing all three verses. Page number 83 in your hymnals. Give everybody a chance to get there. Everybody doing all right this morning?
Amen.
All right, page 83, sing it on the first verse.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world, the birds their carols raise, the morning bright, the lily white, declares the Maker's praise. This is my Father's world, He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass, He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world, so strong, God is a ruler yet. This is my Father's world, the battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth in heaven be one.
Amen. Great seeing you this morning. Please remain standing for scripture reading.
Going with me this morning as we read Isaiah chapter 46, verses 8 through 10. Isaiah 46, verses 8 through 10. This is referenced in the hymn we sing, "Be still, my soul, the hour is hastening on, when we shall be forever with the Lord, when disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow forgot, love's purest joy is restored. Be still, my soul, when chains and tears are past, all safe and blessed we shall meet at last." Amen. Isaiah 46, again verse 8 through 10. "Remember this and show yourselves men. Bring it again to mind, O ye transgressors. Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is none else. I am God and there is none like me. Declaring the men from the end and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure." Amen.
Very comforting words in an unsettled world. God is still on His throne. Amen. Trust in Him. Let's pray. Father in heaven, this day we come to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, asking for His sake, Father, that you would bless our church and all of our members, that together we might be united in faith and truth and spirit and love to do the work that you've left us here to do. Help us always, Father, to be reminded of the work and the seriousness of it. And not only that, Father, the pleasures we get from doing it, that your blessings far outweigh the blessings of the world if we don't. Lord, we ask that you would be with those who are here today, our visitors. Lord, that you would bless them and meet their needs. But especially, Father, we ask that you would bless our church, that we might be the church in our community that we need to be, that we might be doing the work that you've left us to do, winning souls for your glory, doing all the Father for everything in your glory and your honor. Bless our pastor as he leads us. Give him the grace and the strength. Even though he's a busy man, Father, we know that through you and with your help, he will be able. Father, we ask that you would bless the preaching of your word today, because we look to that for faith, for wisdom, for understanding. Without our faith, it would be possible to please you, Father. So just bless us and use us for your glory. We ask in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. If you see a man running around with a camera, just ignore him, okay? Brother Daniel's taking some pictures for the church website, and so just act like he's not even there. Just, you know, have your hymnals and sing and smile, and just don't pay attention to him, which, you know, we never pay attention to him anyway, so it's not that big of a difference. If you would take your hymnals, turn to page 404, page 404, Jesus is all the world to me. I'm going to sing all four verses, page 404, on that first verse.
Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go. No other one can change me so. When I am sad, he makes me glad. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, my friend in trials sore. I go to him for blessings, and he gave him all and all. He sends the sunshine and the rain. He sends the harvest, golden grain, sunshine and rain, harvest of grain. He is my friend. Jesus is all the to him I'll be. When he's so true to me, following him I know I'm right. He watches o'er me day and night, following him by day and night.
Jesus is all the world to me. I want the better friend.
I'll trust him when I see
the
nation.
Amen.
Beautiful life with such a friend. Beautiful life that has no end.
Amen. Great singing this morning.
How long since you stayed?
Jesus is the best friend we could ever have. Amen. Let's all stand, take our hymnals, turn to page 589. What a friend we have in Jesus. Page 589. We'll sing all three verses. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. Amen. Let's sing it out on that first verse.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear.
Going to sing this last verse, but really understand what we're singing. This is one of my favorite hymns because it's Jesus is our friend, right? He's not just Jesus, you know, God up in heaven. He's our friend. We can know him and we can tell him anything and everything. And let's just communicate this last verse all together and just sing it out. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Just give it to Jesus. He's the greatest friend we could ever have. Sing it out on this last verse.
Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with the load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord.
Sing it out.
Do thy princess voice forsake.
Great singing this morning.
Well, all I see but one of the Boyd clan are all up in Oklahoma City and there to celebrate in a special celebration with Pastor Gary Boyd and his earning of a master's degree. That's been taking place today up there in Oklahoma area, and we wish for them the very best, and we'd like to say congratulations to Pastor Gary Boyd. And we praise God for him, his wife, family, and the work that they're doing there in Oklahoma. All right, let's bow for prayer and ask the Lord to bless our time. Father of heaven, we do thank you for your goodness to us, Lord. We pray that you'd bless each one. Lord, there are a number of people in our church going through difficult times, health issues, issues regarding accidents of late. We pray you continue to be with Brother Jordan, help him to heal up. We thank you, Father, for your protective hand upon his life and his family. Lord, I pray that you'd bless our time together today in the Word as we start a very short series today. Lord, I pray that you'd help me. Lord, I need your help always, but especially, Lord, in messages like this, I pray that nothing would be lost that you would have me explain or you would have me to elaborate or build upon, Lord, and then you would take my little bit of effort. Lord, you'd take my little bit and you'd do a whole lot with it in the lives of your people. Father, I pray and I trust you to do your work through your Spirit, through your Word. And so I give it my best, knowing that you will take my little bit and do a lot with it. So, Father, I pray that you'd bless the gifts now of your people. Help us to be faithful and true and grow in this grace of giving also. And, Lord, that you'd help us always to be mindful that the time is coming when the trump of God should sound. Help us to be found faithful when you come. In Jesus' holy name, we pray these things. Amen.
That I love and hold dear to my heart, they're just borrowed, they're not mine at all. Jesus, only let me use them to brighten my life. So I'm human, and humans forget. So remind me, dear Lord. Nothing good have I done to deserve God's own Son. I'm not worthy of the nails in his hands. Still he chose the road to Calvary to die in my stead. Why he loved me, I can't understand. Remember, I'm human, and humans forget. So remind me, dear Lord. So remind me, remind me.
Brother Tim and family were just able to go by and visit with Pastor Ben Springer and encourage them. I appreciate the many of you in your travels and business trips that you've taken, that you've made special effort to be able to get over there to Noonan, Georgia, and to be a blessing to one of our own sent out. And I was just mentioning to Brother Tim that Brother Ben has to get his legs under him. He said he's very tired, and I said, it's a balance act. It really is. It's not an act, but it's a balance. And it's quite difficult when you first get going. And I appreciate the so many of you that have made a special effort to get there and to be a blessing to him and to Elizabeth. as well as the kids. Elizabeth sent me a video just the other day, just about 3 days ago, three or four days ago, and it has a little Jack on there, and he's absolutely determined. He says, I want to be a preacher. I want to be a preacher. Preachers change the whole world. That's why I want to be a preacher. I want to be a preacher. Out of the mouth of babes. Amen. I'll show it to you sometime. Maybe send it out on email, but it's just a great thing to see. She knew that'd be a blessing to my heart, as it is, I'm sure, to their own. Rarely in world history do we find someone who is so near, so close, so endearing to one who is so great, who turns out to be so bad and wicked as this man. Rarely in world history do you find someone who is personally endowed by physical traits, so benefited by the goodwill of his father, so blessed by the masses and the land than this man. This man, of course, is the son of David by the name Absalom. Absalom. The name Absalom stands right out and up there alongside that of Jezebel, Ahab, and Judas. The story of David is about a young shepherd boy who becomes king. The story of Absalom is about a king's son who becomes a tyrant, a selfish cull, a bully, a manipulator, a user of other people, a useless hunk of flesh on bones. One who orchestrates a plot to die for and does. Turn to 2 Samuel chapter 13. 2 Samuel chapter 13. Absalom, of course, is born with a silver spoon in his mouth and great looks and standing to boot. He was Mr. GQ before there was a Mr. GQ. He was Fabio before there was a Fabio and he ever took his first picture. This was Solomon. I'm sorry, this was Absalom. Absalom had great intellect. Absalom the Great had great standing. He had great physical attributes and qualities. He was recognized as the most handsome in the land, the most handsome. He had great favor. He was the favorite of his dad, King David. He had the highest of connections. He had the highest of financial assets. He had the highest standing. You've never found a man who had so much, who was so wicked as this man. Now, in this age, our age, men are more often than not driven by self than the Savior. Driven by self than the Savior. Absalom represents a pattern of heart and hand. A pattern of heart and hand that we're going to get at, that the masses, if you would, are attempting to get the same thing that Absalom wanted, his way. They're attempting to get all that they want, stepping on others, using others, brutalizing others, and more. To people like Absalom, people are pawns or punks. They're pawns or punks to be used or to be shunned. People are just a means to these type of people. They're just a means to an end. And when they're finished with them, they toss them up on the dung heap to rot over time. Such wicked, wicked people. Now this morning, I'd like to read quite a bit of different selected passages contributing to the whole of the story of Absalom. And the choice is a hard task. I really had a hard time trying to figure out exactly what to read because there's several chapters, of course, given to the story of Absalom. You say, why in the world would God so ordain that so many chapters be designated and given to the story of Absalom? So I think, number one, so we would not be like him. Number two, that we wouldn't be caught up in one of his types of plots. And three, that we would understand God's sovereign care over King David under a time such as this. So I'm going to try to make some applications as we go through here. And then I would ask you to include these chapters in your Bible reading in the next week or so. And I want you to go, of course, chapter 13 through chapter 19. So 2 Samuel chapter 13, verses 1, of course, through chapter 19, the end of the chapter. And then Sunday week, the week after Father's Day, next Sunday's Father's Day, I'm going to put some more meat on the bones as we try to gain some greater insight from the life of Solomon. Now, and understand, the patterns, don't get so locked up, if you would, on the names and the dates and the background. I want you to see patterns of human behavior, patterns of wickedness in this world. In this world, there are really only two types of people, those who are following God and those who are following self. Really just two. Now, you know as well as I do that the fact that those who believe themselves and are indeed following self are in fact following Satan and the world. It's basically saying the same thing. John writes, "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever." The Lord Jesus Christ said in John 8, "Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it." So we know there's only two basically ways anybody's going to go in this world. One is you're going to follow God. Are you going to follow self? And by following self, you're following the world, you're following Satan. Only two different courses in this world. Absalom was the third son of King David. Absalom was the favorite son of King David. He was the most handsome son, the most handsome man in the land. So noted in the Word of God. He was the most popular son. However, he was not heir to the throne. He was not heir to the throne. That fell to Amnon, his half-brother. Now we are introduced to Absalom in 2 Samuel chapter 13, where we find a horrific, just a terrible event takes place. Amnon, the heir to the throne, was obsessed with his sister, his half-sister by the name of Tamar. Tamar was a very, very beautiful young lady and an honorable girl before God. She was a virgin before God. She was cream of the crop. And her brother had a perversion. And it was going to play out. Now Tamar is the only daughter of David that's actually named in the Bible, and likely because of its relevance to the story here, of course, of Amnon and Absalom. She was the full sister of Absalom. And half-sister, of course, of Amnon. And Amnon became so full of lust, so full of sin and wickedness, he wanted to violate her. And worked with a wicked friend to put it all together. He faked being sick to get the attention of the king, his father. So he used even his own father in the plot for this damnable work against his own sister. David then, of course, asked Tamar at Amnon's request to go cook and serve her brother to help him get better and to see him and encourage. And she did this in an effort to honor the father and, of course, help her brother get better, but it was a trap. It was a horrible trap. He was faking it all so he could take this young girl, his sister. He was faking it all. He made the men leave the room when she was serving and asked her to bring the food rather into his bedchamber. And there he forced her. He raped his own sister. This sister, full sister of Absalom, crushing her, crushing the life of this girl. These days are not like today. And of course, she wore the apparel, the special apparel of a virgin. She was shamed. She went out crying, humiliated. And to make matters worse, he put her away, adding further insult to her great injury. Poor Tamar put ashes on her head, tore her beautiful dress, and signifying, of course, that she was a virgin before God and man, and she went out crying. We pick up in verse 20 in this story of chapter 13. And Absalom, her brother, said unto her, "Hath Amnon thy brother been with thee?" Something was already known, see? Something was already known there. "And behold, now, hold now thy peace, my sister, he is thy brother. Regard not this thing." So Tamar remained desolate in her brother's, Absalom's, house. But when King David heard of all these things, he was very wroth. Now, he should have been more than just wroth. In all fairness, he should have been more than wroth. He should have acted. David should have acted. Who's David? He's king. He's king in the land. And he should have acted and brought justice, but he did not. Was it a mistake? Obviously. Obviously. Great sin. Great mistake, without question. Justice was the role, was one of the functions of the king. And he failed to meet his obligation. But justice is not the function of the brother. Not the function of the brother. Not a citizen. So David's not perfect. And in fact, we see here, and there's a lot of relevance to us, that those in authority, they're not perfect. But they are in authority. They are in authority. From this day forward, Absalom is plotting wickedness. If not before. But I know nothing in the biblical text that mandates that he is. But I don't doubt that it even went on because he's asking already, "Have you been with Amnon?" So I'm going to suggest to you there's maybe at least hints in the Word of God that he was already corrupt. And I think he was. Now this is not the beginning of Absalom's wickedness. This is what triggers his great wickedness. You hear about people that are in prison and they do interviews with people who have done horrible, horrible things. And when they did those horrible acts, that wasn't the beginning of their wickedness. But usually if you find out or you read their stories, you find out there was something that triggered, flipped the switch. And then here it all comes rolling out. And you see the manifestation of all this wickedness in great wicked plots. In chapter 13, look at verse 22. "And Absalom spake unto his brother Amnon, neither good nor bad, for Absalom hated Amnon because he had forced his sister Tamar." Verse 23, "And it came to pass after 2 full years that Absalom had sheep shearers in Baal Hazor, which is beside Ephraim, and Absalom invited all the king's son. And Absalom came to the king and said, 'Behold, now thy servant hath sheep shearers. Let the king, I beseech thee, his servants go with thy servant.'" Now there's a lot of lies already built up in verse 24 from Absalom. "And the king," David, of course, "said to Absalom, 'Nay, my son, let us not all now go, lest we be chargeable unto thee.' And he pressed him, howbeit he would not go, but blessed him. Then said Absalom, 'If not, I pray thee, let my brother Amnon go with us.' And the king said unto him," already leery, see, "'Why should he go with thee?' But Absalom pressed him that he let Amnon and all the king's sons go with him. Now Absalom had commanded his servant, saying, 'Mark ye now, when Amnon's heart is merry with wine, and when I say unto you," one more reason not to drink, "'smite Amnon, then kill him. Fear not, have not I commanded you? Be courageous, be valiant.'" Absalom did not kill his brother. He didn't want to get his hands dirty, not directly. He had his men murder his own brother. King David, of course, he hears about it, tears his clothes, and he lays on the earth in great mourning for his son. Verse 38. "So Absalom fled and went to Geshur and was there 3 years. And that's up in Syria, Golan Heights, if you're interested today. And the soul of King David longed to go forth unto Absalom, for he was comforted concerning Amnon, seeing he was dead." Now David was a military man. He had seen a lot of death in his years, and even in his family, including, it seems, his second son, who likely died when he was young, because he's not in the picture in this order. It goes from 1 to 3. So he'd come to terms here with his son, Amnon, being dead, and still longed for his son, Absalom. Still longed for his son, Absalom, his favorite son. Verse 21, and the king said unto Joab, behold now, I have done this thing. Go therefore, bring the young man, Absalom, again. Bring him back. Now he's been gone for years. Bring him back to Jerusalem. And he was to return to his own house, but not to the house of David, not the palace. David said, he's not allowed to see my face, but I want him near me. I want him close. I want him back here in Jerusalem. Yet we see the sentiment of the people of Israel was all for Absalom. Absalom's the hero. He took matters in his own hands. Absalom, he's our man. He's our man. And he played right into all of that. You see the sentiment of the people of Israel. Absalom was great. Absalom had been working what he saw as pawns of the people. And he'd been working the people for his own gain. In verse 25, but in all Israel there was none to be so much praised as Absalom for his beauty. I told you. From the sole of his foot even to the crown of his head, there was no blemish in him. He had beautiful feet. He had beautiful everything. He had beautiful hair. He was it, man. And he knew it. It had more than gone to his head, it had gone to his heart. The Bible says there was no blemish in him. Verse 26, and when he polled his head, what in the world is being polled? He's got a pole in his head? No, it's talking about he got his hair cut. Got his hair shaved, cut off. The Bible says, for it was as every year's end that he polled it because the hair was heavy on him, therefore he polled it. He weighed, now talking about vanity, he weighed the hair of his head at 200 shekels after the king's weight. That's about 5 pounds of hair that he cut off every year. 5 pounds. Now, I wanted to include this, but I didn't have biblical writ to mandate it, but I'm going to throw it out anyway. There are some that say that he powdered his hair and he did special things to make it grow even more, and he powdered his hair with gold dust so that when he's pampering and flaunting himself out into the public, he would glow of gold and kingliness. Now, that's not in the Bible, but there it is. But I'll tell you this, it fits his character. It fits his character. Verse 27, and unto Absalom there was born 3 sons and 1 daughter whose name was Tamar. Well, that probably has some interesting things as to why and wherefore. She was a woman of fair countenance. In other words, she as well was very beautiful. So Absalom dwelt 2 full years in Jerusalem and saw not the king's face. So now after 3 years being over there in Syria and Golan Heights, now he's come back, he's in Jerusalem, but he can't see the king's face, and now 2 years have passed. After 2 years, Absalom sends twice to Joab, David's right-hand man, yet Joab wouldn't come to him. Joab's thinking, if the king won't see you, I won't see you. Now, in this, Joab's right on target. Some other times he misses the mark a little bit. But this, if the king won't see you, I'm the king's man, I won't see you. 2 years. Well, that wasn't good enough for Absalom. He's used to getting his way. So he's looking for a way to manipulate, to control other people. So verse 30. Therefore he said unto his servants, see, Joab's field is near mine. So obviously they didn't live far apart. And he hath barley there. Barley, of course, is what they would use for a living, for their food. And set it on fire. Burn Joab's field. Burn his livelihood. And Joab's servants, or Absalom's servants, set the field on fire. Again, notice, Absalom didn't do it. But he had his servants set the field of Joab's farm on fire.
Then Joab arose and came to Absalom unto his house. That's exactly what Absalom wanted. And he said to him, wherefore hath thy servant set my field on fire? Why have you burned my farm? Absalom answered, verse 32, behold, I sent unto thee. You're not the king, son. You're not the king, son. But he said, I sent unto thee, saying, come hither. You come here, that I may send thee to the king. I have something for you to do. You're going to do my bidding. And if I can't get it a proper way, I'll get it in an underhanded way. He says, wherefore am I come from Geshur, and had been good for me to have been there still. Now, therefore, let me see the king's face. And if there be any iniquity in me, let him kill me. If I've done anything wrong, you let the king kill me. Now, he deserves it. But it's nothing more than manipulation on his part. It's nothing more than manipulation. Using others again to get his own way. He knew of his great popularity with the people, and he knew David would not take his life, both on a personal level and a provisional, a kingly level. He would not take his life. But he throws this out as if I've done wrong, if I have sinned, which he obviously had, let the king kill me. And then, of course, he would have more to complain about. Well, he wouldn't, but his family would. He'd be dead. Look at verse 33. So Joab came to the king and told him. When he called for Absalom, he came to the king and bowed himself on his face to the ground before the king. And the king kissed Absalom. David still very deeply and profoundly loved his son. Loved him. Absalom started making a big show of himself before the people of Israel. Look at chapter 15, beginning in verse 1. It came to pass after this that Absalom prepared him chariots of horses and horses. Not one. He had a fleet. And they're not going to be the low end. They're going to be the highest end. And the highest horses. And 50 men to run before him. So he's in his chariot, all duded up, and he has 50 men running out front of his chariot to announce, Absalom is coming. Absalom is coming. David doesn't have this. Even the king doesn't do this. But Absalom, right? That's what he's all about. 50 men, verse 2. And Absalom rose up early and stood beside the way of the gate. The gate, of course, city commerce, people coming in and out, doing business. And it was so that when any man had a controversy, came to the king for judgment. So they're coming to the king, but they're intercepted. They're intercepted. Then Absalom called unto them, of what city art thou? And he said, thy servant is one of the tribes of Israel. And Absalom said unto him, see, thy matters are good and right. But there is no man deputed of the king to hear thee. There's no one that David has appointed to hear the claims, to hear the complaints, to hear the issues, to hear the lawful complaints to come from the people. David doesn't care for any of you people. That's what he's doing. At the gate of the king. Wicked man. Wicked man. What he's saying, David doesn't have time for you. David has not orchestrated for you. David has not organized for your benefit. It's all about David. Now we know from the life and story of David, that's totally untrue. And all throughout these chapters, you will see David's concern is not near for himself, but for the people that he served. But David doesn't have time for you. I have time for you. Well, he didn't have a job. People don't have a job, have a lot of time on their hands. More about that later. But he's saying, He won't hear you, but I will hear you. I will hear you. I care. Verse 4, and Absalom said, moreover, oh, that I were made judge in the land. Now, he wasn't, had no such authority, but now he's assuming. If I were made judge in the land, that every man which hath any suit or cause might come unto me, and I would do him justice. He would get justice. You're not getting that with my father, but I would give it to you. And it was so that when any man came nigh to him to do him obeisance, he put forth his hand and took him and kissed him. So Absalom's falling all over the people to manipulate the people. And on this manner did Absalom to all Israel that came to the king for judgment. He cut him off at the pass, and then he laid his traps. So Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel, the men who are the ones representing their families coming to take care of business and any complaints or whatever lawful issues before the king. The men. And he stole the hearts of the men of Israel. He starts intercepting complaints from the people of Israel, saying there's no justice with King David, but if I were king, you would get justice here. You'd get justice. I am your man. I am your friend. My father is not. I am your friend. I love you. He's old. He's out of date. We need a new man in town. We need a new justice here, someone who understands you, someone who can relate to the young. Come on. There's a whole lot here. I have time for you. I love you. We know Absalom did not have the great responsibilities of a king, or he wouldn't be standing out there on the wall. How nice for him. He had all the time in the world to do his damning work, his diabolical plot. After a few years of this, he asked, Dad, I need to go back over to Hebron to honor a vow that I made to God. Now, it's all made up, but there it is. Hebron, of course, having been the old capital of David's kingdom and Absalom's birthplace, where a politician, now today we would see this, where a politician wants to go back to their hometown to announce they're going to be running for president of the United States, that's what he's doing. That's what he's doing. He's setting all of this up. Chapter 15, verse 8. And thy servant vowed a vow when I abode at Geshur in Syria. Again, that's Golan Heights up there on the ridges to the east of the Sea of Galilee, saying, if the Lord shall bring me again indeed to Jerusalem, then I will serve the Lord. He's lying right through his teeth. He has no intention of serving the Lord. And the king said unto him, go in peace. So he arose and went to Hebron. But Absalom sent spies throughout all of the tribes of Israel, saying, as soon as you hear the sound of the trumpet. Now I'm going to get over here in Hebron, back where my dad, okay, back in the hometown, and I'm going to set myself up as king. And so he sends out all these spies, saying, as soon as you hear the sound of the trumpet, then shall ye shall say, Absalom reigneth in Hebron. Absalom is king. With Absalom went 200 men out of Jerusalem that were called, and they went in their simplicity, and they knew not anything. They were pawns. They were not aware of his plot. They're just pawns to be by him to be used. And Absalom sent for Ephibosheth. Now, when I look at that word, that's not the way I would pronounce it, but that's the way the computer pronounced it. Ephibosheth. It's a hard word for me. A Galilonite, David's counselor from his city, even from Galilee, while he offered sacrifices. And the conspiracy was strong. It's talking about the conspiracy of Absalom. For the people increased continually with Absalom. And there came a messenger to David saying, the hearts of the men of Israel are after Absalom. David, you're losing the kingdom. The kingdom, the men of the kingdom are following Absalom, your son. And David said unto all his servants that were with him at Jerusalem, arise and let us flee. In other words, he's already got such a following. We have no hope. We're going to have to flee Jerusalem. For we shall not else escape from Absalom. Make speed to depart, lest he overtake us suddenly and bring evil upon us. Listen now, and smite the city with the edge of the sword. In other words, he'll come in here and he'll not only take my life, but he'll kill everybody here in Jerusalem. So we need to leave. We need to escape quickly, quickly now. We need to get out of town. We've got to get out of here. Pack your stuff right now. Let's go. David left Jerusalem in great humility. David was concerned about the people, lest they be murdered by Absalom. Absalom, of course, is using the people and would have anyone killed that got in his way. And what he wanted was the crown. Verse 31 of chapter 15, and one told David, saying, Ahithophel is among the conspirators with Absalom. In other words, your once great counselor, like no other counselor, is now in bed with Absalom. He's part of the conspirators. And David, hey, this is a big deal. This was a great man with great influence and great wisdom. And David said, Lord, I pray thee, turn the counsel of Ahithophel into foolishness. Jump down to verse 37. So Hushai, David's friend, came into the city, and Absalom came into Jerusalem. So David's friend makes his way back into Jerusalem, and now Absalom comes with all his fanfare, of course, into Jerusalem. Verse 15 of chapter 16. And Absalom and all the people, the men of Israel, came to Jerusalem, and Ahithophel with him. Verse 21. And Ahithophel said unto Absalom, go in unto thy father's concubines. So he left 10 concubines there at the house to take care of the house while they left town. So now here's this great counselor, once loyal friend and counselor to King David, now turncoat. Says, I know, tell you what you need to do, son. Wickedness. Go into thy father's concubines, which he hath left to keep the house, and all Israel shall hear that thou art abhorred of thy father. Then shall the hands of all that are with thee be strong. So they spread Absalom a tent, now get this, upon the top of the house. Not in the house, on top of the house. Everybody gets to see. Absalom went in to his father's concubines in the sight of all Israel. Exhibition time. And the counsel of Ahithophel, which he counseled in those days, was as if a man had inquired at the oracle of God. So was all the counsel of Ahithophel, both with David and with Absalom. No counselor had as high esteem as did this man in all of Israel. Great, mighty counselor. Now, chapter 17, this great counselor who stuck his neck out for Absalom, though he had his own agenda. You read through this, it seems like everybody has their agenda. Put forward a plan to Absalom to gather an army and go destroy King David, him hiding in the woods, but kill only David. But that counsel did not please Absalom, so he needed cover. So he's looking for a plausible, what the politicians today called plausible deniability. You hear that term today? Plausible, in other words, they need a little distance between them and the dirty work. And buddy, they're good at it. Well, I didn't know anything about that. Oh, you didn't know anything about your son and all his dealings in Russia and China? You'll know, I don't know nothing. It reminds me of Sergeant Schultz. I know nothing. I see nothing. That's Hogan's Heroes, by the way. You didn't know. So he's looking for somebody else that he can play. By the way, it's also an answer to David's prayer, as David had prayed for his old counselor that his counsel might be turned into foolishness. So Absalom called for another counselor by the name of Hushai, who was a friend, of course, of David secretly, and he threw Ahithophel under the bus. And he presented a counter plan. No, you know, David, he's a strong man. He's a military man. And you better be prepared if you're going to go against your father. So you better gather up more soldiers. And when you actually go in, you wipe them all out. Not just David, but you take them all. You kill them all. Don't leave one man standing. That was his plan. But it really was just a plan to appeal to the fleshly carnal desires of Absalom. but at the same time extend time to David, who needed time to regather his troops. And he knew if he could just give David enough time, the leader would come through and be able to defend himself and the throne. There's a lot of good things here for leaders, by the way. Look at verse 23 of chapter 17. Mephibosheth saw that his counsel was not followed. He saddled his ass and arose and got him home to his house. Why? To his city. Put his household in order and hanged himself and died. That's usually what happens when you hang yourself. And was buried in the sepulcher of his father. So Absalom made war against his own father to steal his father's throne. Against his own father. David sent his army to battle, but instructed the commanders of his army in chapter 18, verse 5. Stay with me now. I'm going somewhere. I promise you, I'm going somewhere. Verse 5. Deal gently for my sake with the young man, even with Absalom. Don't kill him. Don't hurt him. Don't hurt my son. Don't hurt my baby. Don't hurt my boy. And all the people heard when the king gave all the captains charge concerning Absalom. It'd been one thing if he just had a private meeting with his cabinet. But no, that's not. A lot of other people heard. Verse 6. So the people went out into the field against Israel, and the battle was in the wood of Ephraim, where the people of Israel were slain before the servants of David, and there was a great slaughter that day of 20,000 men. That's a huge loss. Verse 8, for the battle they were scattered over the face of all the country, and the wood devoured more people that day than the wood the sword devoured. And much things happen like that in warfare, the confusion and injuries that take place. And Absalom met the servants of David, and Absalom rode upon a mule, and the mule went under the thick boughs of a great oak, the limbs of a great oak, and his head, that fluff, big head boy, full of his locks. His head got hold of the oak, his hair, and he was taken up between heaven and the earth. And the mule that was under him went away. Even the ass knew when to leave. Amen. One of the men told Joab, the captain of the host, Absalom is hung in a tree by his long hair. What a sight that must have been. Here he is trying to hang up there, trying to get it untangled. It was a mess. The same hair that he displayed, bragged about, used for vainglory to manipulate people. Look at verse 11. And Joab said unto the man that told him, behold, thou sawest him. Why didst thou not smite him there to the ground? Why didn't you kill him on the spot? That's what I'd have said if I'd have been writing the book. I would have given thee 10 shekels of silver and a girdle. Yet the soldier appealed, saying, the king said not to harm Absalom. But Joab's having none of that. This is our opportunity. Look at verse 14. Then said Joab, I may not tarry thus with thee. And he took 3 darts in his hand and thrust them through the heart of Absalom while he was yet alive in the midst of the oak. So Absalom, with his long flowing hair, hanging in the oak tree, and he takes 3 darts and he stabs him right in the heart with those darts, leaving them there. You say, why 3? Maybe one for the father, one for the... I don't know. But he got him with 3 of them. And then 10 young men that bear Joab's armor, the armor bearers, compassed about and smote Absalom and slew him, hanging in that tree. Joab blew the trumpet, and the people returned from pursuing after Israel, for Joab held back the people. Strike the leader. And they took Absalom and cast him into a great pit in the wood and laid a very great heap of stones upon him, and all Israel fled, every one to his tent. Though there was a great reluctance to tell King David, of course, who had given instruction not to harm Absalom, right? Don't hurt my son. Finally, he was told, Absalom has been killed. Notice in chapter 18, verse 33. And the king was much moved and went to the chamber over the gate and wept. And as he went, thus he said, O my son, Absalom, my son, Absalom, would God I had died for thee. O Absalom, my son, my son. Chapter 19, verse 1, it was told Joab, behold, the king weepeth and mourneth for Absalom. Not the men who've been lost and the wives who have lost their husbands, the babies who've lost their daddies with David's army, but with Absalom. He's weeping over Absalom. The Bible says, and the victory that day was turned into mourning unto all the people, for the people heard that day how the king was grieved for his son. David works his way back to Jerusalem and pardons all of these enemies. These same people that sought to destroy him, kill him, and take the throne. Bringing peace in the land. Let me quickly give you about six or seven things about the plotting of the wicked. And again, you will see patterns. If you have eyes to see and ears to hear, you will see the same pattern worked out again and again and again throughout history, both individually and corporately, in churches, in corporations, in nations. You'll see it worked out again and again and again. Number one, the plotting of the wicked begins with rejecting God's will and order. That's where it begins. David was ordained king of Israel, not Absalom. Period. That's it. But Absalom is going to reject God's will. I don't care what God's will. I don't care what the Bible says. That's Absalom. That's the pattern. They despise authority as anyone other than themselves. Of course, they set themselves up for authority. Like during the day of Judges, every man did that was right in their own eyes. Jude warns about this. Likewise, also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. We better be careful. Patterns. Number two, the plotting of the wicked searches for allies in their unholy pursuits who are capable, corrupt, and influential. They're going to need help, and they're going to need, in their mind, good, capable help. People who know what's going on and work to influence. They're going to need those as allies. So, of course, David's counselor, Mephibosheth, by the way, who's the grandfather of Bathsheba. You've heard of her. Who turned against him, but one who is highly esteemed and respected. He knows exactly what was going on. Which is greater guilt, knowing it's wrong and still doing it anyway. Number three, the plotting of the wicked, they search not only for people in unholy pursuits who are capable, corrupt, and influential, but they also search for allies, a force, volume, a broad appeal to which they can use as pawns in their plot. You can't overthrow a nation without getting the people involved. Not just the potentates, not just the politicians. You got to get the people, see? You got to get the people involved. And so that's what he does. These people are not necessarily, and more often than not aware of the gravity of the plot. They're not aware of all the backstory. They're not aware of the diabolical scheme that's being put forward by this wicked one. All they know is, well, he understands us. He's our generation. He can preach to us today. You with me? You need those people. If you're like Absalom, you need those people. And they're pawns in the plot. In chapter 15, verse 6, after this manner did Absalom to all Israel that came to the king for judgment, so Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel. In chapter 15, verse 11, the Bible says, they were called and they went in their simplicity and they knew not anything. That's the mass of people. There has to be the few, the influential, those who are capable of pulling ropes, but then there also has to be a broad appeal to people. the masses of people. You got to get more people involved in this thing. Black Lives Matter. You got it. Many of them don't have a clue. This pawns. Palestinians don't have a clue that they're being used. Church members don't have a clue that they're being used by Satan. Father, forgive them. They know not what to do, but they are being used. Number four, the plots of the wicked refuse to wait on the Lord because they're really not looking for the Lord's will anyway. Amnon is dead. The second son is dead. He is the favorite son. If he just waits on the king to naturally die, he would be king. Has every reason to believe that. But these kind of people, they don't wait. They want their way and they want it right now. Number five, the wicked rarely decide to work alone. They want somebody else to do their dirty work. They want somebody else to do their work. They want others to enter into their schemes. They want others to do the dirty work. Absalom did not kill his brother. Absalom would always work to have someone or many others between him and the dirty deeds that he would initiate. Number six, the plotting of the wicked more often than not look for supposed spiritual justification. It's just, God's called me. I mean, how could I reject God? God wants me to be king. They're looking for some way that they can add spiritual justification to the diabolical scheme and plot that they themselves are putting forth. They got to have cover. And what better cover is there than spirituality? How can you argue against that? Well, that's what they're hoping. Chapter 14, verse 32, Absalom answered Joab, "Behold, I send unto thee, saying, Come hither, that I may send thee to the king, to say, Wherefore am I come from Geshur? It has been good for me to have been there still. Now, therefore, let me see the king's face, and if there be any iniquity in me, let him kill me." So he pretended to be spiritual, having done wrong. A few years after, Absalom was allowed to come back to Jerusalem and work overtime to get the people to be loyal to himself and not the king, his father. Then he pretends he's got to go back to Hebron to pay a vow that he made to God. "I'm spiritual, Dad. Dad, I'm following God. This is all a cover for the plot, by the way. And to anyone that doesn't know and doesn't have the discernment, they're going to think, man, Absalom, he's a fine spiritual man. I do think he would be a better leader for Israel than King David. He cares. Don't you see him out there day and night standing at the gate of the city? Don't you see how he appeals to the people? He's the man's people. He's for the common man. He has time for us. He loves us. David doesn't have time for us. Well, he's inside daylight to dark taking care of the needs of the people. The real work that they are not seeing. Undiscerning souls. Look for spiritual justification. He says, "Let me go and pay my vow, which I vowed unto the Lord." And then number seven, and let me end there. The plotting of the wicked is countered by the Lord our God. The plotting of the wicked. If you decide you're going to be a part, either ignorant or whatever, you're going to be part or you're going to be the one who is the Absalom, just know this. You go against God, God's against you. Yeah. God's against you. The plotting of the wicked is countered by the Lord. The Lord turned the counsel of Phishael against him, answering the prayer to David, had Absalom take counsel of another, which gave David the time that he needed to recover and regroup his army. I tried to figure this out, and I wish I could do a little bit better with the words here to make them rhyme better. But Ahithophel fell out of favor. Ahithophel fell out of favor. Ahithophel fell out of favor. And felt his own neck snap at the end of the rope when he hung himself. But I probably shouldn't do it that way because it is a sober subject. Absalom, with his long flowing locks, which he flaunted before the people, cutting his hair, auctioning it off on eBay or Christie's auction house. Nobody wanted that. He dies a brutal death hanging by his hair in an oak tree. By the way, he had one daughter, three sons. They all died early on. Big cost. Big cost to sin. Now David, he's imperfect, but he's the king. He's anointed by God. Moms and dads, you're not perfect. Kids, your moms and dads are not perfect, but they are the parents. There's gold here. You can load up your pockets with this if you have a mind to, or you can be a fool and dismiss all that I'm going to say. God ordained your mom and dad to be authorities over you. God ordained churches and leaders in churches. God has set up. Young people, they're working for other people. There's a boss, and the boss is probably not you. You better learn the lessons. David, though imperfect, admits the same in his own humility. He knows he's imperfect, but he's righteous before the Lord and protected by the Lord. Parents, we're not perfect, but we are protected by God. Leaders, we're not perfect, but if we live in the fear of God, seek to do right, though imperfectly, we will be protected by God. You will be protected by God. Others may plot against you. They may work overtime to ruin your life. But there is a God above who sees and He knows all things. The Bible says, but the salvation of the righteous is of the Lord, and He is their strength in the time of trouble. Psalm 37:39. Deuteronomy 31:6. Be strong and of good courage. Fear not, nor be afraid of them, for the Lord thy God, He it is that doth go with thee. He will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. This world is plotting against us as Christians. There are people who are plotting against this church. People plotting against me. People are plotting against our nation. On and on and on and on it goes. Number one, don't be an Absalom. Number two, don't be one of those people who pull the strings. Oh, I like pulling strings. Yeah, there's a place in people like Absalom's plots for people like you. Those who have the abilities, they understand and they like it. Let me pull the strings of other people, the other group of people that we need to create the mass appeal. And they don't know what's going on. They're just people, often good people. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. They don't realize they've been swept up in a plot of the zealots in Israel, of the Sanhedrin. They don't know. But they are there nonetheless. Don't be the simpletons for the Absaloms. Stand with God. Do right till the stars fall. And if you find others are plotting or you don't even know this. There is a God. And He's watching over you. He's watching over those who would do right. Imperfect? Yes. But they're seeking to do right. No, God will protect you. Let's stand. Lord, now I trust You to do Your work in our hearts. I've been giving myself to this now for 2 weeks and trying to figure out how I might in an orderly fashion present this before Your people and our guest. But I trust that You can take something like this and do great things with it. And I ask You to do so in all sincerity. In Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to come and pray as we sing, page 494, Wherever He Leads, I'll Go.
Take up thy cross and follow. I heard my Master say,
Let that be our prayer, each and every one of us. Let that be our prayer this morning. Let's go ahead and be dismissed in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for your word preached this morning. Lord, help us all just be faithful to you and faithful to your cause, faithful to your word, glorifying you, obeying you, listening to your instruction. We thank you so much for this church and for just those that are here this morning, visitors and members. Pray for those who weren't able to attend, be it sickness or those traveling for work or vacations, stuff like that. Keep them safe. Bring them back to us. Let me pray for this week. Just help us to live for you and just devote our minds and our actions to your glory, Lord. Bless us this day. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.